All right, welcome to Downtime. I'm Dave.
I'm Mike.
And we're doing things outside today.
Special social distancing episode of Downtime right here.
Well, yeah, all these other talk shows are doing the no audience thing. We've beaten all of them to the punch on that one. So we just decided to change up the situation with us. And our guest today is Sophia Marie Joseph.
Hello.
Hi.
Cranford High School student and published author. It's very exciting.
Thank you. Yeah, it was a big process for me. I've always loved writing, so I always knew that I wanted to be publishing a book at a young age. Mm-hmm. But yeah, yesterday the book was released, and that was really a big deal for me.
I can imagine. And your age of 16, that's incredible.
Yeah, I go to high school. I'm in the gifted program at my school, mm-hmm. so I have to do like a lot of work and stuff. But writing is really, it's my passion, so it's something I always do every single day.
That's fantastic.
All right, so in addition to being an author, you're also what, on the swim team?
Yeah.
And I think you have some other things you do alongside that?
Yeah. I guess I like to overwhelm myself. Yeah. So I do swimming. I currently am not swimming because it's a winter sport.
Yep.
But I would swim for Cranford High School and the YMCA Devilfish.
Oh, wow.
And then in the spring, I'll be doing cheerleading and union.
That's incredible. You have time management skills that I envy, if you're able to do all those things and become a published author in the meantime. So I guess let's get started with what would you say is your writing process? Are you more of a get something down every day type of person, or is it more, you know, you wait till inspiration strikes and you just go from there?
So as a writer, I have to have like organization. So I do like entire complex outlines, and then from there I start writing. Like, I can't say I write every day, because like I try to write every day, but if I don't feel it, like if it doesn't feel right, then I just have to delete it. Mm-hmm. Like, it's really whenever everything, like when the stars align, when the universe is like, yes, this is perfect, then that's my writing.
The muse just speaks to you and the words happen.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Thank you.
All right, before we get into the content of the book, let's talk about the publishing aspect of the book.
So publishing it was quite an experience. So I used Amazon to publish it. They have a publishing company called Kindle Direct Publishing.
Mm-hmm.
And so with KDP, basically, you upload your manuscript, you find someone who's going to do your illustrating for you. All
right.
And then you upload all that, and then they let you do like expanded distribution, which means like, you know, libraries, bookstores, they can all buy it and stuff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it's a fun process.
Sounds interesting. It sounds a little nerve-wracking.
Oh,
but
yeah.
What's the process of actually, because now do you have an editor with this?
No, I edited it myself.
Okay.
I read it very a lot, so that way I make sure I have all the grammar mistakes out of it.
Well, that's great. I can imagine that that must take a lot of passion, because now what would you say is the, not really difficult, but like the part of the process that you didn't know going into it, and now it's just like, oh, I didn't know this was a thing.
I guess finding an illustrator was like one of the most, parts of it. Because you have to find someone like you genuinely trust to do something so important for you.
Right.
Like, I knew I'd have to find one, but I didn't know it was going to be like such a difficult process to find the right one.
And now the illustrator is
Vanessa Mendozi.
Right.
I found her on a website called Readzy. It's a community for writers, editors, publishers, all of them to come together.
Mm-hmm.
Just basically to help, you know, authors get like their best book out there.
Okay. Now, you obviously love to write. Have you been writing from a young age?
Yeah, ever since I was a little kid. Like, aww. When I was little, I would be making up little stories. Like, I'd write them down on printer paper.
Aww.
Like, for me, like, I love telling stories. Like, as a little kid, I would tell stories to my grandfather. And, like, for me, writing, it's always been a part of me.
Aww.
Like, I've had difficulty with words, so writing them down, I found it's easier than saying them aloud.
Mm-hmm. So, let's talk a little bit about the book now. We've gone over the editing, the publishing, the illustrating, but tell us a little bit about the book.
Okay. So basically, my book is about a fictitious Portuguese drug cartel, and basically they start a drug war, essentially. Oh. So, background information, Portugal has... They basically legalized all drugs, essentially, so that way they could deal with addictions. And so they used to have, like, a really bad drug problem, and, mm-hmm. like, from that, I kind of started to get the idea of the book, basically. So, basically, there's this kingpin by the name of Beatriz, and she is the leader of the Madeira cartel. And basically, her lover tries to kill their daughter. Oh. And because of that, she kills her lover. And that starts an entire drug war between these two cartels. And oh. that's what the whole book is essentially about.
I'm hooked already, and I've just heard the plot summary.
All right. I'm going to ask a question that I hope doesn't get anybody in trouble. Besides that, where's the inspiration for any of the characters in here, the plot, anything of that nature?
Okay, so when I was in middle school, I watched this couple, and this guy was in love with this girl, but she did not love him back. And it was this unrequited love. And that's really where I got the idea for this book, because he was so in love with her, he would do anything for her, but she didn't give him the time of day. And so in my book, there's this guy named Vincenzo, and he's in love with Beatriz. He would do anything for her. Mm-hmm. And so basically that relationship, like, what are you willing to do when you love someone? Like, that's a big theme of the book.
Okay. That's... I'm... So that's what inspiration. Now, did you have to do any research for this? Or?
Yeah. So basically, I did some research on Portugal's history, and they used to have a dictatorship under, I believe he was the president, his name was Salazar. And so essentially that during that time, Portugal's economy, like, dropped. Mm-hmm. And so we know, like, during economic drops, people start turning to illegal things. So that's kind of where the idea of what if this drug cartel developed, you mm-hmm. know, as a way of making money.
Okay. That's... Now, which would you say is your favorite part of writing? Are you more of a dialogue person, a character person, world builder? Oh, really?
I have to say character, because, like, it's almost like I'm making children in a way, because I know I know their every detail.
Yep.
I know their passion, their history.
Yep. And a lot of that's not even going to end up in the book.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
Now, do you have a... how do you keep that straight, and what's your suggestion to other people who may have, you know, 5 or 6 word documents of barely finished novellas? Like, are you the sort of, do all those characters sort of live up here, or do you have, I know for TV they have what's called a show Bible, where it's just like, okay, well, yep. here's this character and here's 4 pages worth of backstory.
I guess I'd say I have a show Bible, because I have an outline where I basically planned out every single character, their entire life, their history, even their parents, like who they are. And I even planned out, so Portuguese names are very long. I gave them all very long names to follow that tradition, most of which doesn't even make it into the book.
That's a credit to you as a as a creator of worlds, basically.
Yeah. I feel like a god, to be honest.
Yeah. All right, I'm not going to ask what happens to any of the characters in here, but I know some authors, let's just say, bad things happening to your characters.
Oh, yeah.
Well, obviously something bad or less than favorable has to happen. That's conflict, that's story. But do you ever feel any guilt when something bad happens to these characters, or are you one of those people you can just kill them off, like, they're fictional, they go away?
I feel immense guilt because, so I've been in, when I was in 6th grade, I read Game of Thrones.
Oh, there it is, there it is.
6th grade, really?
Yeah, I love reading, so I'm, like, a very violent author. I do, like, massacres, so I kill off a lot of characters, but, like, I genuinely do feel remorse about it, because I know their entire soul, and I just let them die like that, but I kind of know, like, I have to do it for the sake of the story, like, it's what needs to happen.
Well, yeah, I'm just thinking, like, George R. R. Martin, back when he was writing books, you know, I wish I could get paid to not write a book, but, you know, we all can't do that. He had a great saying, which is, nobody kills my characters but me.
Oh, yeah.
So, a little sense of pride in that, at the very least. So, I'm thinking a little ahead of myself. Do you plan on doing more with these characters,
yes.
or...?
I'm actually planning a sequel right now. It's about the life of the daughter of Beatriz. She grows up with her mom as a kingpin. So just kind of focusing on her character and what it's like living in that sort of world.
That's I already want to know more about these characters. Yeah. It sounds like it's intriguing, but it's also, you can tell that there's like a human element to it.
Yeah.
And now, if someone else, like, let's say that, again, you're still in high school, if a freshman comes up to you and says, I heard you published a book, what advice can you give me? What's your advice to, like, you know, other young and aspiring writers and authors?
I guess I'd have to say, like, people think just because they're young they can't do something, but literally anyone can write a book. It's not about being born with talent. It's about writing every day and putting dedication into it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all you have to do is you have to work at it. But if you work at it, you can really publish a book. You just have to have that motivation and care about it. You can't just throw words on a page. It has to have a story, an element. Like, you have to put life into it.
Alright.
And I also add that it's easier to do that now than ever. Is that it used to be, if you wanted, all right, so where do you want to go with this? Do you want to keep writing? Do you have something else in mind? Is this going to be just one of many things you do?
So I have my entire life planned out. So basically, I want to be a writer for the rest of my life. Like, that is my ideal world, just publishing books. So this summer, I'll be taking literature classes at Brown University.
Oh, wow.
I plan on taking comparative literature at Columbia while going to high school next year.
Oh.
If I get into Columbia,
yeah.
I'm still waiting to find out about that. And then I want to publish more books before high school ends. I want to go to college, major in English. I'd like to build schools in impoverished countries because I believe you should spread literacy to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And then really just spend my life making books and making an impact on this world.
You know, you were not kidding when you said you had your whole life planned out.
At the age of 16, too. That's, trying to think what I was doing at 16. Wasn't planning on applying for colleges already, so you're an inspiration right there.
Thank you.
We were probably reading comic books and watching anime. Let's not kid ourselves.
Yeah. But no, that's that's wonderful. That's a great goal and a great dream. It sounds like obviously writing is important to you, but it's more of a sharing stories type of thing, and I think that comes across just by talking to you, and I believe that it comes across in this book, too.
Yeah.
Now, would you say that, now obviously you have your life planned out. Now, when it comes to the story, though, would you say that you had an outline where you had, beats that, obviously big beats and plot points planned out beforehand, or are you more of, okay, here are these characters, here's this setting, and then I'm just going to see what happens organically?
So this is my second version of the book. The first version, I just kind of wrote whatever came to mind. Mm-hmm. And the second version, I was like, okay, I'm going to make an entire outline of every chapter. So I kind of I like to have structure with it. Like,
okay.
I like to know what's going to happen. It makes it easier for me to at least write it out.
All right. That's fantastic.
You ever... Do you ever have a situation where you're writing a scene, you plan it out, and you realize what you're planning out is not going to work for the scene?
Yeah. Because sometimes it's just like, this character wouldn't do that. They're not nice enough to be like that.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you get to those moments, have you ever, in the writing process, both with this book and with anything else you may have written, where you get to the point where you had this idea and you really love it, but you just can't... Try as much, you just can't fit it into the story. You can't get the square peg through the round hole.
Yes. Like, sometimes it's just like, it's not going to flow naturally, so even no matter how much I love it, it's gotta be thrown out.
Mm.
Sometimes I try to make it work, but sometimes you just, like, I remember there were some scenes I really liked, but I was like, okay, I can save this for the sequel instead. Then it
oh, that's
better.
Good. That's good. Well, yeah, there's, I know some people who are authors, they say getting rid of some of those scenes is kind of like amputating a limb.
Oh,
it's like, you had something lined up, you can't make it fit, it just, you're losing a part of yourself in the process.
One of the hardest things for really any creative, especially authors more so, is writing in a voice that's not your own.
Ah, yes.
Now... And that's very difficult. There's many a published author, people who get paid millions and millions of dollars to write stuff, and they can't do unique character dialogue. Not going to throw Joss Whedon under the bus, but Joss Whedon is one of them. Now, what is your process to sort of get into a headspace of, kingpin of a drug cartel or something like that.
I guess, like, with all of my characters, like, they're human, so I have, like, a little piece of myself in them. But I kind of, like I said, I like to outline them first. That way, I know their entire soul, so it's, like, it's easier for me. Like, there's this one scene, and it's Beatrice and Vincenzo. And, like, she's, like, in the book, it says, she almost said, I love you. And I know that she wouldn't say, I love you. She would think about it.
Yeah.
But she's, in blunt words, she's too much of a horrible person to ever love another person. So I have to, like, I can't be myself because I'm a very gentle person, mm-hmm. so I'm not a kingpin of a drug cartel. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I really have to know them so I can get their dialogue correctly.
That also gets me thinking, was there any author or book you thought was an influence going into this?
Definitely Game of Thrones helped with the more violent aspects. And I'd have to say, oddly enough, Harry Potter. Because when I read Harry Potter in fifth grade, that's actually what got me started. Like, I want to publish a book.
Yeah.
So ever since then, it's like, that's kind of been like a driving force where I want to be like J.K. Rowling one day.
Mm-hmm. So now you've mentioned that there's a sequel idea. Is this a... I got this on the brain because I just threw shade at Joss Whedon, but it's like, if you would continue, are you interested in like furthering stuff that's happening sort of in this universe of the book,
yeah.
or can we, looking at this, can we prepare ourselves? Is this the start of the Sophia Marie Joseph verse, basically?
I think the second book is going to be the end of this little universe, because
right.
I think that's. Like, the perfect way to end it. Like, my book was originally going to be a short story for a competition, but then I was like, this is way too long to be a short story. So I think that the second book will be the end of this little universe, but knowing me, I'm going to get more ideas, and it's going to become an even bigger universe.
Do you have a favorite character? And it doesn't necessarily need to be one of the mains, just like, you have like a little throw-in secondary character that's just like, oh...
I guess it'd have to be Constanza and Vincenzo. So basically, Constanza, she is the nanny of Beatrice's daughter. And she's basically the mother of this little girl because Beatrice is too busy being a kingpin to care for her little girl. And then Vincenzo, he's so in love with Beatrice, he would do anything for her. And in a way, it's so admirable to see someone love someone that much.
Aww. I'm getting there. This character's kind of the heart of the book.
He really is.
Yeah. All right. Do we have anything else?
All right. I'm going to go home on Amazon and I'm going to purchase my copy since it's available now. You sold it well, and I'm definitely interested in reading this. I got to stop myself from just like leafing through it right now.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're a little busy right now, but I'm also going to get on this. And you said Amazon. Any other ways to get this, or?
I'm trying to get it into libraries and bookstores, but I'm working on that. So for now, just Amazon.
All right.
That's fantastic. Sophia, thank you so much for your time.
Of course, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for having us. We'll be right back with Downtime.
And we're back. That was a fantastic interview, and I'm definitely looking forward to. We each got our own copies.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sophia. I'm definitely looking forward to reading this during my long hours, cooped up inside while we're all self-quarantined.
Yeah. We try to keep things at least a little bit evergreen here, but you can't really have a show right now without talking about everything going on.
Which is why we're doing Downtime Unplugged out here outside the municipal building, which is actually, it's a nice day for it.
Very nice day. But not everybody has the luxury of going outside, and we're going to give you a couple ideas of what you can do while you're self-quarantined, and thank you, Sophia, for the wonderful pivot, because reading a book, wonderful thing to do right now. I like to pretend I read more than I do. I'm going to be open up there about that. Now that I'm stuck inside, I don't want to look at my screen all day.
Crazy.
And this is a nice, easy read, I think, for a lot of people. Very... Mm-hmm. We were skimming through it. We liked what we saw.
And after just hearing her talk about these characters, I'm just like, I had to stop myself from just like, oh, really? Just leafing through it during the interview.
Yeah. But it seems like everybody's kind of caught on to the fact that we're all going to be stuck inside. Mm-hmm. Rise of Skywalker got released on home distribution a couple days early. Every video game manufacturer in the country is having a sale right now. Yep. This is very hard for people like me who have very... I'm normally good with self-control, but you give me a Steam sale, I have to put my wallet away for a little bit. I'm going to collect games I will never play.
Yeah, no, and that's also... I talk about not being a reader. I am using this opportunity to buy all those books where I'm like, oh, yeah, I heard about this on a podcast, and they've been sitting on a shelf for 3 years.
Yeah.
But Steam is... I've redesigned my farm in Stardew Valley already.
Oh, no. You know things are bad when the farming simulators get touched with.
Nice. Got some turnips grown in. Coming in nicely.
Yeah, digital turnips.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, they're... Digital turnips are all you have. Have you been to grocery stores lately?
Yeah.
So, what games have you been playing? What's your new obsession?
Well, Borderlands 3 just dropped on Steam, and I'm one of those guys who's played all those games. Mm-hmm. And I had it preloaded, because I normally don't like doing that. I had it preloaded, and day of launch, which was as of taping today, there was a 10 gigabyte patch. And I'm like, no, I don't trust this. I'm giving this another day or two to figure itself out before this thing ruins my computer or crashes, anything like that. Yeah. Everybody has a Netflix queue right now. You binge watching anything to get through this?
Well, talking about hiding your wallet away to get away from the Steam sales, I've had to stop because Archer is available on Amazon Prime, and you can buy a whole season for like $12. So,
oh no,
I have two whole seasons, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna stop right now.
Yeah.
But beyond that, and stuff that's already available on Netflix, is I've finally got around to finishing Dark Crystal: Age of Resistance. That's one of those I watched the first two or three episodes and were like, I'll get back to this later.
Yep.
And, well, later's today, apparently. I like the original movie, and it's got I'm looking this up online, it's an all-star cast.
Yeah, and it's kind of nice that the Henson sons have always gotten the attention, and it's the Henson daughters now who are handling this, so it's kind of nice that they're changing that up a little bit.
It's truly original. I'm a sucker for practical effects. So yeah, the fact that they've got all the Skeksis and all the Gelflings with their creepy dead eyes, like my brother refuses to watch them because it traumatized him so much as a kid. I'm just like, what? Skeksis are cool. The Gelflings, though, they're like little gremlins. Just like you know, wake up, they're gonna steal your socks or something. Aside from that, there's also binge watching The Office for the 132nd time.
Well, I'm going to say something that's going to eliminate our entire Gen Z audience, which is that I could never really get into The Office when it was airing, so I'm feeling a little left out about this weird nostalgia for it right now. I mean, like the British one, that's a little different for me, but...
Yeah, that's Ricky Gervais.
Yeah. I just think that did a better job showing how bad people they all were.
Yeah.
And I think kind of my problem with the American version is they kind of accepted that they were all bad people and were supposed to root for them.
Yeah.
And British shows are a lot better at saying you're not supposed to like any of these characters and you're supposed to deal with it.
Yeah,
so
kind of going off that, and this is a bit of a tangent, but have you heard of this great British show? I'd say binge watch it, but there's only it's a British show. There's only like eight episodes. Have you ever heard of The Young Ones?
I have not. There's a new one for me.
Rick Mayall, who passed away a few years back. It's just these it's all these college-age kids. They're all horrible people.
Yeah.
But they tried to, they tried to pitch it in to the U.S., and the first thing the U.S. producers were like, who's the hero? Who are we rooting for?
Yeah.
And they had to go, no one. You're supposed to just sit and laugh at the idiots. Which, if you want to laugh at idiots, it's a great show. Random, and it's a little vulgar, but I like it.
Yeah, we haven't had anything like that since Seinfeld in America. We're supposed to root for everybody now.
Mm-hmm. I can understand that. In these dark times, sometimes you need someone to root for, but sometimes you just want it's kind of like the opposite, where it's just like, okay, all bets are off. I guess you kind of have that a little bit with Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Yeah.
But it's just like, it's okay, I'm just going to watch this person. Curb is also a great show to binge watch if you have the ability to.
Yeah.
And on that sad, somber note, we have to say goodbye to this lovely day and to our lovely audience. And go back to our, you know, dingy cells, watching TV, and watching Downtime. And thank you for watching.
Yep, and we're not doctors, but you know the advice. Stay distant, don't shake hands, wash your hands for 20 seconds at a time, long enough to sing Happy Birthday twice, or the chorus to Jolene if you're sick of singing that.
Also, the Team Rocket motto works too, but only the one where Wobbuffet interrupts me out at the end.
I think we just lost a bunch of our audience, and with that, goodbye, thank you, we'll see you next time.